All right, so just gonna wait a couple seconds here, see if everybody's on. Alrighty, looks like everybody's in. So today, we're gonna cover something that needs to be addressed. It seems that no one knows exactly what a VAR is. So what is a VAR, or kvar? Anyone?
Hold on, can I Google it?
Isn't that a value-added reseller, or value at risk?
VAR? I go to the bar all the time. Oh wait, you said VAR.
Video assistant referee, duh.
What?
I have no idea.
Hey Alexa, what's a kvar?
This might answer your question. According to fandom, according to superfriends.fandom.com, a kvar is a Kryptonian who was born on...
Isn't that the foam on the beer?
Eric, unmute yourself, please.
Oh my, yeah, that's like the wasted capacity in a transformer.
Now we're getting somewhere.
Wait, isn't that related to power factor?
I've heard that explanation many a times and I still don't understand it.
VARs are produced by capacitors and inductors use VARs.
Oh wait, I found it on Google. It's imaginary power.
Yes.
Power that isn't real?
That really doesn't make sense to me.
Well, Wikipedia says volt amps reactive, right?
Come on, guys. It's the y-axis on the power triangle.
It's the angle difference between voltage and current that allows motors to spin.
Very good. That's actually pretty close.
So people think volts times amps equals watts, but that only works for DC. For AC power systems, volts times amps equals volt amps, and we also have to consider real and reactive power. To understand reactive power, we have to understand what a VAR is.
For engineers, electricians, or anyone dealing with electricity, we ask them to take a leap of faith to believe and therefore understand electricity, something that we can't see, but then we even go one step further and ask them to believe in imaginary power, which by definition doesn't exist, or does it? So for us to understand what reactive or imaginary power is, we will look at the technical definition as well as several analogies so that hopefully we can all come away with an understanding of what a VAR really is.
Alternating current, or AC, is a 60 hertz sine wave that oscillates back and forth. So if you have a regular incandescent light bulb, the electrons are actually rubbing back and forth in the wire. The resistance of the light bulb acts almost like a friction that heats up the element and causes it to illuminate. If the frequency was lower, like 2 hertz for example, you would see the bulb go on and off, but because it is so fast, the element doesn't have time to cool down and stop shining. Looking at the graph, we can see that the voltage and current are in phase for this resistive load. Because power equals voltage times current, we can see our power curve. Notice that since the voltage and current are negative at the same time, it results in a positive power consumption by the light bulb. Now, let's see what a purely inductive load would look like. Notice how the current lags the voltage by 90 degrees. Calculating the power yields 2 positive and 2 negative areas in the curve. This right here is why reactive power is also called imaginary power. The inductor is actually charging and discharging twice each cycle to yield no net power consumption. There is still a real current associated with this imaginary power that does travel through the wires, but it just oscillates back and forth through the inductor and yields no work, just a magnetic field. It is easy to see the 120 Hz power curve here because there are 2 complete power cycles for every 160 Hz voltage cycle. This concept is the same for a purely capacitive load. The only difference is that the current leads the voltage by 90 degrees. The capacitor charges and discharges twice per cycle, and the reactive power establishes an electric field between the metal plates. This action or reaction is where the term originates. VAR, or volt amps reactive, describes how the inductor or capacitor react to the system by delaying the current or voltage. Now, it is worth noting that purely inductive or capacitive loads do not exist. This is because every component has some inherent resistance to it. Real loads are a combination of resistive, inductive, and capacitive elements. This results in a current that leads or lags the voltage. The combination type load results in 2 large positive humps and 2 smaller negative humps. The negative humps are canceled out by some of the area of the larger two, and the remainder is the real power consumed by the load, which in the case of a motor is released in the form of mechanical power. Inductive motors cause the current to lag, and capacitors are used to force the current back. This is where the terms leading or lagging power factor come into play. Leading means your system is more capacitive, and lagging means your system is more inductive, which is more common. For generators, the mechanical power input equals the real electrical power output. The reactive power required by the generator is only used to excite and magnetize the inductive field windings. This is where they get their name, because they produce a magnetic field. The resultant magnetic field isn't doing any real work. Kind of like this permanent magnet generator right here. There is a magnet that, while stationary, isn't doing any work. However, if I spin the shaft, I am going to force the magnetic field to rotate through the armature winding, and this requires real work because of the electromotive force, or EMF, voltage induced in those windings. This EMF is physically resisting my mechanical input because of the electric power demanded by the load. In my case, it's just this simple LED. But in the case of a utility system, the load is a combination type that requires some reactive power. That reactive power, although not doing real work, does require real current which flows through the armature windings. This is why generators are rated in voltamps, or apparent power, which is the rooted sum of the squares of both real and reactive power. Reactive power current flowing in the armature windings causes them to overheat, just like the current of the real power component. Many people just reference the kilowatt rating, but you have to consider both to understand the actual capacity of a generator. And keep in mind that the load is what demands the reactive power that the generator then supplies. Without a load, there is no current, and you just have the open circuit voltage multiplied by a current of zero, yielding no power at all. But remember, the armature windings are inductive, so they play a role in the overall circuit when a load is connected.
Most of the time when professors or technical people talk about reactive power or VARs, they have a hard time explaining exactly what imaginary power is. To try to make it real for people to understand, many analogies have been made to explain the unexplainable. Here are some of our favorite analogies that might make sense to you. None are perfect, but maybe visualizing them will help you to understand or explain to others what a VAR is. Probably the most common analogy to explain what reactive power is the beer analogy. With this one, the mug size, or capacity, is compared to the kVA rating of a transformer, which is the transformer's capacity. Utilities bill us on kilowatts, or kilowatt hours, which is real power, or in the analogy, is compared to the beer. The foam takes up space and essentially wastes capacity of the mug, or the transformer. The foam is compared to the reactive power, or kvar. So if you remove the foam, you can fit more beer in the glass, or real power. From a power system standpoint, adding capacitors compensates for the motor loads on the system and allows you to add more real watts or loads to your transformer. The walking analogy explains real and reactive power in a very simple way. If your goal is to walk across the room, you can lift your leg a little and have a long stride. This does the most work, or moves you forward the most. Or you could do a high knee march and have a lot of effort without really moving forward much. Your goal is to move forward or do work, which is similar to kilowatts. And the upward motion is required to move, but not helping to move forward, and this is similar to kvar. The bicycle analogy is interesting as it explains power systems like this. A bicycle with 10 seats has 5 people with pedals doing the work and acting like generators, and 5 of them are just riders and acting like a load. The generators have to pull the loads, and as long as the loads cooperate and sit up straight, the generators can just do real work moving the bike forward. This is compared to kilowatts. If the riders or loads become disruptive and lean, the generators have to lean the opposite way to compensate. This does no work, but is required to keep the bike stable. This action is compared to VARs on the power system. From a business standpoint, productive or direct employees can bill hours directly against a job, where overhead employees, like sales or management, are considered non-productive or general and overhead. Productive employees are like the real power. Overhead employees are like the reactive power. Both are needed to run a company, but only the productive employees can bill labor hours directly against a job, thereby doing real work. Without the overhead to manage and create opportunities for real work to be done, the business would fail. 2 other visualizations include a boat in a channel and a person pulling a block on the ground. For both of these examples, moving the boat or block requires real work or kilowatts, and the angle of the rope or the hypotenuse of the triangle is related to kVA. The angle is related to power factor and ties in the requirement for reactive power or VARs. Here at the PSEC, along with showing real loads and measurements, we often use many of these analogies to explain reactive power. We have also built the water analogy, which helps to explain some of these concepts and others. In the water analogy demo, we use this storage tank as a capacitor, and we show this water wheel as an inductor. The capacitor can be operated in parallel with a transformer and shows how you can relieve the capacity in a transformer. The inductor or water wheel shows how it takes a lot of inrush current or inductive kick to get the motor going, and then once it's moving, it requires very little real power or work to keep it moving, like a hamster on a wheel. Again, just like a motor, just enough to overcome friction. For each of us, we have a favorite analogy or one of the technical explanations that makes more sense than others. For me, to understand what a VAR is, I personally like the following explanation using an induction motor. An induction motor needs a magnetic field to actually spin. So if you have an unloaded motor and apply voltage, the motor will spin, but it's doing very little work. In fact, just enough to overcome friction. In order to make the motor spin, loaded or unloaded, you need a magnetic field. The power required to create this magnetic field is called reactive power, imaginary power, or yes, VARs. To maintain this magnetic field, we really aren't doing any real work. As the motor is loaded and you're actually doing mechanical work like lifting an elevator or moving a conveyor, you will require some real power or watts. In fact, the work you do increases linearly with the real power you put in. But since the magnetic field is required to spin the motor, loaded or unloaded, the VARs or reactive power increases slightly, but at a much lower rate per amount of work you put in. The ratio of kilowatts to kVA, which equals the power factor, reaches the rated power factor for a motor, which is usually about 0.8 or 0.85 at full load. The power triangle defines the watts on the x-axis, the VARs on the y-axis, and the apparent power, or VA, on the hypotenuse. You can see how this power triangle changes from no load at about 0.1 power factor to 0.8 power factor at full load. Watts are real power and must be created by a source of power, like a generator. And to do this, energy in the form of mechanical power or fuel is used to maintain conservation of energy. Since magnetic or reactive power requires no energy to be created, we call it imaginary power. In electrical systems, the opposite of an inductor is a capacitor. To compensate for inductive load like a motor, a capacitor actually draws current 180 degrees out of phase and therefore is said to be a VAR generator and compensates for the VARs required by the motor.
So now that we have defined reactive power and looked at several analogies to explain what a VAR is, let's take a look at real measurements and see how VARs behave on power systems. One thing to consider is that loads take the real and reactive power that they need. For this case, the load is 71 kilowatts, 73 kilovar, and 101 kVA with a 0.7 power factor. From a system standpoint, the addition of capacitors, or VARs, improves the ratio of real power, or kW, and apparent power, or kVA, upstream from the capacitor location by reducing the net reactive power, or kVARs. In this case, we are adding 15 kVAR at a time until we negate the 73 kVAR of the load. Notice that when we actually overdo it and overcompensate with capacitors, the kVAR goes back up, the current goes back up, and the power factor goes down again, but is shown as a leading power factor. Unfortunately, the mysterious nature of reactive power and the fact that VARs are not easily understood has left the door open for unscrupulous and sometimes unknowing salespeople to sell capacitors as energy-saving devices. They argue that reducing the volt amperes level by adding capacitors will reduce your real power demand, or kW, and your energy usage, or kilowatt hours. They often confuse people saying that energy efficiency is the same as the power factor, but it isn't. Electrical efficiency refers to power out over the power in. This goes back to our discussion about the conservation of energy that we mentioned earlier. The difference in output and input is kW losses. We did an entire video on this important subject because, although you can reduce the reactive power, which reduces the current and the kVA, while also improving power factor with capacitors, you don't save real power as claimed by these black box companies. Can capacitors save you money? Absolutely, if you have a power factor penalty, which would only be the case for some large commercial and industrial loads, but never for your home. If only everyone understood the concept of reactive power. So why do you need to know what a VAR is? To accurately size the equipment you are using, you have to understand the difference between watts and voltamperes for AC power systems. Professors and teachers gloss over the concept as if it really isn't that important, but without understanding VARs or reactive power, you cannot fully understand the power triangle. Understanding the magnetic field requirements for motors and how capacitors are used to supply that field will help you understand reactive power and VARs. The important thing you should realize is that reactive power exists, and loads like motors and capacitors require actual current even when they are doing no real work. Hopefully, you now have a working understanding and not just an abstract understanding of reactive power.
To learn more about reactive power, or if you have a great analogy that you'd like to share with us to describe this elusive concept, contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to the Power Systems Experience Center today.